Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
If we will all stand, if you are able, and we're going to sing our joy song, which is Beautiful Sunday.
Reader today is Nancy, and our musician is our beloved Bill Hoffman, accompanied by our beloved Rick. Our speaker is Reverend Marita, and okay, at 1 minute.
Okay, so this is a reading from a book by Jon Kabat-Zinn, and it's called Wherever You Go, There You Are. Even though he had no job to go to, no children to feed and get off to school, no external reasons to get up early, it was Thoreau's custom for the time he lived at Walden to wake early in the morning and bathe in the pond at dawn. Yummy? Lee's going, no. He did it for inner reasons as a spiritual discipline in itself. He wrote, it was a religious experience, exercise, and one of the best things I did. Benjamin Franklin also extolled the virtues of health, wealth, and wisdom obtained from waking up early and his well-known adage on the subject. But he didn't mouth it. He practiced, too. The virtues of getting up early have nothing to do with cramming more hours of busyness and industry into one's day. Just the opposite. They stem from the stillness and solitude of the hour and the potential to use that time to expand consciousness, to contemplate, to make time for being, for purposefully not doing anything. The peacefulness, the darkness, the dawn, the stillness all contribute to making early morning a special time for mindfulness practice. Waking early has the added value of giving you a very real head start on the day. If you can begin your day with a firm foundation in mindfulness and inner peacefulness, then when you do have to get going and start doing, it is much more likely that the doing will flow out of your being. You are more likely to carry a robust mindfulness and inner calmness and balance of mind with you throughout that day than you had just jumping out of bed and started in on the call of demands and responsibilities, however pressing and important. The power of waking up early in the morning is so great that it can have a profound effect on a person's life, even without formal mindfulness practice. Just witnessing the dawn each day is a wake-up call in itself. And in Thoreau's book, Walden, he says, morning is when I am awake and there is a dawn in me. We must learn to reawaken and keep ourselves awake, not by mechanical aids, but by an infinite expectation of the dawn which does not forsake us in our soundest sleep. I know of no more encouraging fact than the unquestionable ability of man to elevate his life by conscious endeavor. It is something to be able to paint a particular picture or to carve a statue and so to make a few objects beautiful. But it is far more glorious to carve and paint the very atmosphere and medium through which we look, to affect the quality of the day. That is the highest of arts.
Thank you, Nancy. All right, our opening hymn is number 65, He Healeth Me. We'll sing both verses. Number 65, He Healeth Me, both verses. Stand as you are able.
Thank you.
I on? She said this.
I am on.
Okay, so, good. This morning, I wanted to read from Matthew 5:14, very well-known passage. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. Glorify your Father which is in heaven. Those words, ye are the light of the world. I want to do something just a little different this morning. I would like you to close your eyes and know the truth of yourself. It's been found that, and I believe I've mentioned it before, that human bodies exude light, photons. So physically, you are the light. You are the light of your world. Right now, for a few moments, would you imagine that light within you, filling you? Not only filling you, but spilling out in the air beside you, beneath you, above you. And see that light moving out to the people who are sitting near you. And then gradually intermingling with all the light being exuded by everyone in this room. You are sharing what you are every day of your life. And this morning you are sharing the light of your own soul. The light of your Christ being. You're sharing it with everyone in this room, blessing them, lifting them, healing them. That light is the light of love, not just a physical light. But the light of God's own love through you. Now let's spread that light throughout this city, all the neighborhoods, your neighborhood, and everyone else's. And now send it out to the whole state of Virginia. Imagine it spreading far and wide, blessing so many people. See that light within you spreading throughout our whole country and healing those people who are desperate, who are unhappy, who are fearful, who are angry, who hold in their hearts all kind of negative emotions, thoughts, and feelings. Finally, spread your light throughout the whole world, everywhere, healing, blessing, sending love, sending wholeness and balance, sending freedom and peace. And gradually Allow the light to return to you. Allow it to remain not only within you, but all around you. And whomever you will speak to or touch or even think about this day will feel that light of love and peace and understanding and joy, goodness, they will feel it, whether they are conscious of it or not. For this light that is not only within us, but it is all around us, our light, God's light shining through us. For that light, we give such deep thanks this day. Thank you, thank you, thank you, dear God. And now shall we say our divine science statement of being? God is all, both visible and invisible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am the individualized expression of God, and am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance.
Morning.
Surprise.
You didn't hear nothing yet. I'm instead of playing the tune I had originally thought about playing this morning, Rick and I just had a little huddle, and given what we just did, we're going to invite you all to join us in singing a tune. It's called This Little Light of Mine.
All right.
We just made this up. So. F to say.
Everybody,
oh, this little light of mine.
the time in our service that we allow ourselves just to be. So I'm doing two meditations this morning. But that's all right. As Nancy said, we need that time for mindfulness, for meditation, for being quiet, for just being. And so, right now, we take a deep breath and give thanks for this miraculous body of ours. The more we read about the discoveries that have been uncovered through various scientific studies, the more we marvel at this miraculous vehicle, this wondrous body that we use to express what we are inside, which is the image and likeness of God. Through this physical vehicle, this expression that other people look at and say, oh yeah, that's, and then they think of your name. But you are not just your name. That does not begin to express 0.1% of you. The image of God means wondrous things. It means understanding. It means peace, knowledge, love. It means compassion, givingness, kindness, patience, forgiveness. It means expressing those spiritual qualities that we just call, oh, she or he, they're so nice. And we can do this every day of our lives in so many ways. Countless ways. Express what we are inside. This day, we can just nod at a stranger or smile. This day, we can give someone a compliment. This day, we can tell somebody we love them. This day, we can express our appreciation for what somebody has done. And this day above all, we can thank God for all that we have, all the wonderful things we have experienced, and for all the wonderful things to come. For as we expect them, give thanks for them, they have the most marvelous way of showing up. Those synchronicities, those moments when we get unexpected help, blessings, peace of mind, all from the mind of God, all from the bounty of God through others, through life, through nature. This day, during our 90 seconds of silence, we are going to think of those wonderful things that are going on in our bodies right now, digesting the breakfast we had. Processing the air that we breathe, the beating of the heart, the function of the kidneys and lungs, liver, all the internal organs. The blessing the body is and the marvelous opportunity that it gives us to be all we can be as we walk the earth. God's image and likeness. So starting now, start giving thanks. Unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We have rested temporarily in the arms of God. We have given thanks for what we have been given. We give thanks for those blessings yet to come, for the good that we have been able to spread around. And certainly we give thanks for God's blessings on all the people who are on our Valley Community Church prayer list. God stands ready to help at any moment. We have but to turn to Him. We have but to say, help. Help me. Doesn't have to be fancy words, just a heart full of need. And as we turn to Him in that need, in that trust, blessings unfold, goodness, understanding, connection. All that and so much more. And for that and everything else, we give deepest thanks. Amen. Now, you'll find in your orders of service a rather new form of the Lord's Prayer, taken from the Dura Foundation. Everybody have one? Yes. Perhaps we could turn up the lights a little bit so people can see it. Thank you. Thank you. And together then. Our Father, who is everywhere, your name is sacred. Your kingdom is come, your will is throughout the earth, even as it is throughout the universe. You give us our needful bread, day by day, And forgive us our offenses, even as we forgive our offenders. And let us not into temptation to materialism, but you separate us from error, because yours are the kingdom, the power, and the song and praise from all ages throughout all ages. In the name of Christ. Today I'm going to be talking about life eternal. Somebody asked me last week, I think it was, are you going to talk about near-death experience? And I said, no, I don't think so. Well, guess what? Many of you know that I spent from the 28th of August to the 1st of September up in King of Prussia, no less, King of Prussia, Pennsylvania, just south of Philadelphia, attending the Conference of Near-Death Studies. And it was spectacular. It was something else. It was beautiful, truly. Lots of excellent speakers, some people who had done many, many scientific studies of near-death. Actually, these studies have been going on since the early 80s, believe it or not. And in Charlottesville alone, that's where it all kind of started. In Charlottesville alone, there must be tens of thousands of accounts of near-death experiences in their files. Also present were, in addition to just the speakers who were researchers, there were many who were authors of books about near-death. And there was a very large group of experiencers who were usually very willing to share their experiences with you and tell you about it, as well as a lot of people who are just interested in that subject. There were psychics, there were healers there, different kinds, but everybody was so friendly and outgoing and helpful. Interesting people, really. Now, accounts of near-death experiences have been going on for a very, very long time, as long ago as Pliny the Elder and Plato. They wrote about it, believe it or not. There are stories of people who had these life-transforming experiences during the Middle Ages. But there was an enormous spike of incidences since the 1960s. Why? Well, people have been doing various kinds of CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, since the 1700s, actually, with greater or less success. But when people who appeared to have died when experiencing drowning or being strangled or frozen, they were brought back to life on a number of different occasions through chest compressions and breathing into the mouth. Back then, that was the method of doing it. But then there were other methods, too, which were way out, far less than helpful, actually. But then, in the 60s, there was a dramatic increase in successful resuscitations when defibrillators were added, and they were developed to be both small and very powerful, and they were used not only in the emergency rooms throughout a hospital, but they were also used in ambulances. See, the average person can't survive without oxygen for more than six minutes. Then brain is gone. Now, when people were discovered who were unconscious, they had no pulse, they had zero blood pressure, they weren't breathing, and then their heart was not beating, it was just fibrillating. What they began doing is the combination of the chest compressions and oxygen in the mouth, but then the defibrillator, which shocked the heart and brought it back into a sinus rhythm. And many, many more people began surviving these kinds of experiences. And of course, they began having more and the ease. It became more popular, more, not popular, it's never popular, but more frequent, I should say. So instead of dying, they had these life-transforming experiences. It's estimated that anywhere between 5 and 15% of the adult population of this country has had an NDE, and that amounts to about 19 million people. Now that's just the adults, because they didn't take anybody into those studies who was less than 18 years old. And actually, there are people who have experienced near death in the womb, believe it or not, as infants, as babies, and young children, preteens, teens, etc. So this number should be 19 million, a lot of people, but there probably are a great many more. So what are the signs that you've had an NDE? Everyone doesn't have all these experiences, but everyone has some of these same experiences. Some people have had just out-of-body experiences, like when there's an operation and someone finds themselves somewhere near the ceiling watching the operation take place. Or they wander down the halls of the hospital. But their memory about this is perfect. They're able to tell the doctor, oh my, well, you said this, and this one did that, and very accurately, too, right on the subject, right on the spot. The common experiences that people know about is that you see a tunnel, and there's a light at the end of the tunnel, and you go into the light, and you are met and just completely enveloped in an all-consuming love. But there are so many, many more experiences within the NDE. They find themselves with their senses so much more acute. They see beautiful landscapes, but with the most vivid colors, and colors that we don't see on Earth. There is speed of thought and clarity of thought, clear thinking. Time slows down. There's a sense of timelessness, actually, in these experiences. Sometimes there's a life review where you see everything that you've ever done, but you also see how it affected other people. You feel their feelings at the time. But there's never any judgment in the life review. There's just a loving support throughout for the individual who's experiencing that. Some see pets they loved. Some hear heavenly music, choirs. Some hear loud buzzing or ringing sounds. But at some point, they're told, you have to go back. You have to go back to the world. And routinely, everybody resists. No, I don't want to go back. They don't want to go back. You don't want to go back to a body that's been mortally or very severely wounded. They want to stay in this wondrous place, this place that is love incarnate, their eternal home. Some reluctantly know that they have to go back because they have young children. Those children need them. One man who was resisting vehemently was asked, what have you learned and who have you helped? He came back. He chose to come back. So every experience is unique. It's different, every one of them. But it's fitted perfectly for the experiencer. It's just what they need to feel and hear and know. Now, for a very small percentage of the NDEers, these moments are frightening. Maybe 5% of the 5% that experiences. Just a small number. These experiences, these NDEs, negative ones, have just an uncomfortable fear and a sense of isolation, sometimes guilt or even anger. And as they remember it afterwards, they hate it. They are somehow shriveled up inside knowing about it. But as they think about it through the years, as you get further and further away from it, they begin to see it from another perspective and realize that the things they learned within it really did help them. Those who have had near-death experiences are profoundly, underscore that word, profoundly changed by the experience. Now, bad people, by the way, do not have bad experiences, and good people have good experiences. No, no. Some very good people have had bad experiences, and vice versa. One man experienced such overwhelming love and joy and ecstasy in his NDE, he tried to recreate it through drugs and alcohol. And he wasted many years of his life until a second NDE reoriented him. And after that, he never took another drug or another drink. As a matter of fact, he went back to school, became a nurse, and spent the rest of his life helping other people. Few people take that kind of terribly negative direction after the NDE, but it's found that it takes anywhere from 7 to 10 and as much as 20 years to integrate this NDE into their lives, because there is such a total change. There are psychological changes, certainly, and physical after effects on a scale that they never experienced before. Their personalities are transformed. The son of one man said, "This is not the same man who raised me." They begin thinking very differently. They're not more religious. They are more spiritual. And that is, no matter how religious or spiritual they were before, it has increased dramatically. And that is true even of atheists. They are not atheists anymore. They are convinced from then on of the reality of a universal presence of absolute love. And the ears see themselves as part of a benevolent universe. Einstein said that was one of the most important questions. Is it a friendly universe? And they answer resoundingly, yes, it is. They find themselves with a deeper concern for other people, a new appreciation of life. Every day is a wonderful thing. They have absolutely no fear of death ever again. Their IQ increases, believe it or not. They become less competitive and less motivated for, say, things like power or money, for things. There was one man in California who lived for things. He wanted the biggest house he could afford and the fanciest cars in the driveway, and he wanted his stock portfolio always increasing and increasing, and that was the drive until he had an NDE. And he must have had an understanding wife, because they sold the great big house and they got rid of the big expensive cars and opted for a much more modest lifestyle. That was not his goal anymore. And things are never the goal again. And the ears become more generous. They sometimes experience depression. Some of them because what they tasted of the next step in life beckoned them, made them want to get back there. But they knew, and this is routine, that there is a life purpose. And if they didn't know what it was, they look for it. They look for it. They become more intuitive. Some of them are very, very psychic. As a matter of fact, some who had total recall of the events that happened in their lives also have a an experience of what is to come, both in their lives and in the world. They become much more sensitive to light and sound. There's a heightened intelligence, more creativity, more inventiveness. They have less tolerance for strong medications and anything that's chemically treated. Their electromagnetic field changes quite dramatically. Watches don't burn on them, clocks stop, electrical equipment sometimes stops around them. I knew a lady once who had two, she had been hit by lightning twice, and she clocks and watches did not work around her at all. There are a great many other after effects, and I don't have time to go into them this morning, but take it from me that there are. But why am I talking about this? What in the world does this have to do with divine science? The people who came to the movie last Thursday know why. Because in this DVD, they saw what some people learned during their NDE, and what was revealed to them in these profound experiences is, in my estimation, pure divine science. It's what we teach in this church every day, every Sunday. Am I bragging? No. But it is so wonderful to hear a corroboration of the things that we hold important out of the mouth of a man who was raised as a Mormon. These truths. What they learned is that we are all one, that we are all connected. Jeff is the name of the man in the NDE that they ran on Thursday. He said, it was as if they were all me. That sense of connection, that sense of being one with everybody else. Now, this is not something so unusual. Edgar Mitchell, who was the sixth man to walk on the moon, had a similar realization coming back from the moon. He saw that everything, the celestial bodies, the earth, and everyone on the earth, everything is connected. He realized it, and he gave up a life of scientific inquiry and began examining the inner world rather than the outer world, consciousness. Now, we say we're all connected. We're all one with one another, and all things because we are part of God, and God is the ground of the universe. God is the basic energy in this universe from which all things spring. God and God in action is all there is. There is an inseparable connection between all of us and everything else. Another truth he learned. There are no accidents. There's a reason for everything, and there is a divine order in all things. Despite how unexpected it is, or how wonderful it is, or how horrible it is, or exasperating, or confusing things are, there are unseen reasons for it, and there is great good within it. But only time will reveal that good. Only in retrospect to see the good that came out of it. So, whatever circumstances you are in, trust that there is a reason for it and there is good within it for you. You know, listening to that truth, hearing those words and internalizing them will save you so much worry. Oh, things are, oh, they shouldn't be. No. It will save you many sleepless nights if you realize, if you remember, that there's a reason for everything and that there is, no matter on the face of it what it is, there is good within it. Another realization, or revelation, was that God sees us as perfect. We see ourselves as flawed. God doesn't see us that way. God sees us as perfect. So there is never any reason to forgive us. Jeff felt this deep guilt because he was driving the car when this awful accident occurred. God sees our mistakes as opportunities for us to learn. We were all given free will, the right to choose, and that's, we can choose at all times in whatever way we so decide. Now, as painful as that crash was, tremendous good came out of it, and there was absolutely no blame, no judgment by God or anyone else in Jeff's NDE. Now get this one. Jeff was told that he was God. That's blasphemy. Nope, it's not blasphemy. We are all gods. We're all divine within us. We have always been divine. Jesus himself quoted the 82nd Psalm, which has God saying this, I have said ye are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High. Right out of the 82nd Psalm. And it's the truth. In divine science, we don't say, you are a god, or I'm a god. We say, I am the individualized expression of God and am ever one with his perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. But what it really means is that I am a part of God, I am God's representative, I am God. So we are forever part of this universal divine presence of love. Once when Jeff was praying terribly, terribly worried about his son, who was going through a very, very bad time, an unforgettable voice said to him, why are you judging your son? Judge not. This is perfect for him. He's right where he should be. Just love him unconditionally. And things turned out beautifully for that son who seemed to be in such a bad way. Bad things happening. We are all exactly where we should be. Every one of us. We're there to learn the lessons we need to learn. Finally, love, they say, and we agree, is the most powerful thing in the universe. It's God's nature. Love. They were told, serve others. Choose joy, because we can choose how we're going to feel. Choose joy. Choose kindness. Choose compassion. And one final, very excellent suggestion. Quote, if you long for a spiritual experience, each morning ask, what can I do to serve another person this day? These are NDE revelations. And they sound like divine science to me, right down the line. How wonderful to hear these things out of people who have never heard of our faith. So I give thanks, and I hope all you do too. Shall we go within? They bear words and ideas, concepts of great power, of great truth. These people who have gone through near death, they come back, so many of them, bearing messages of hope, bearing messages of love, of oneness, bearing messages that ring true, that somehow touch us at our deepest level. And so we are grateful to them and grateful to God that they are, day by day, expressing more and more of what we, who have not had these experiences, what we need to hear. Thank you, beloved. Thank you, dear God. Thank you. Amen.
Well, back to the program. I'm going to play a tune by one of my favorite composers. He's Antonio Carlos Jobim. He's Brazilian. Or was. He's in that other world. He didn't come back. Usually when I play this, I play it kind of slow and sexy. Not so much this time. I'm going to speed it up a little bit and do a little joy. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Maureen, thank you for transporting us, and Bill, thank you for transporting us. Okay, now it's time for a blessing of the gifts. We can read together in orders of service. Today, I acknowledge God, omnipresent, as the source of all good, as the source of my good. With this acknowledgement, I accept His will, which is abundance in every aspect of my life. I release all thoughts of lack and limitation, and I am open and receptive to the increased flow of abundance to me right now. I joyfully accept the gifts of life and give freely of the special gift that I am. Through me, God the Omnipresent blesses and multiplies this gift for all. Thank you, dear God.
Announcements again today, so settle back. First off, I do want to say something about the movie we saw Thursday night. It was, I just can't explain it. It was really good. We would like to show it again if anybody is interested. It's a two-hour movie, probably about an hour and 45 minutes if we take off the question and answers and just have a discussion amongst ourselves. But it was very, very good, and I would highly recommend that as many of you that would like to see it. And we thought maybe if I have enough people, I can show it on. I know it's hard to come on during the week for 2 hours in the evening, so maybe we can show it on a Saturday or a Sunday afternoon or something. So just get with me if you want to see it, and we'll make arrangements to show this movie again. I think Marita says she's watched it 4 times or something, so it's very, very good, and so anyhow, very well worth watching. So I'd be willing to show it again or more than once if we need to do that. So let me know if you're interested in watching this. And speaking of that, your meeting is this Friday night?
Yes. Yes.
Right on.
We have an MBD support group that's been having a meeting with the church, and it is going to work on Friday evening, see a DVD, and discuss it. 7 o'clock over there. So we'd love to have anybody who is interested, please come.
Okay, and as last week I told you to take these home, and it has all the events on them, and they're all subject to change, and someone's already changing. As we said last week, on here we have that we were going to go to the toastery next Sunday for lunch. Well, instead, we're going to support our wonderful musician here next Saturday night. He's playing at Montano's, and we're going to go to dinner there around 7 o'clock. So anybody that's interested in going, let me know today or tomorrow, because I'm going to call and make reservations. And we appreciate Bill stepping in for William today. William Penn has got some kind of virus or something, so make sure we say prayers for him. He was supposed to be here, and he's not feeling well. So, Bill, we always enjoy having you here, so thank you. I forgot what your name was. He made a new name up today. William. So, anyhow, we really appreciate that. But we hope to see you on Saturday night. We plan to be there to support you. Let's see, we have a work day next Saturday. Next Saturday will be a busy day. You can work all day and then go to Montana's for dinner. We have a work day scheduled from 8 to 12. We're going to do some yard work, but we're also going to do some painting. The outside doors need to be painted and the rails. So that's one of the things that we're going to be doing. And also, we, as you know, we've been doing this little store in here, and Martha's been taking care of it. And we've just, people just been bringing stuff and bringing stuff, and which is wonderful. We've made over $700 since the first of the year on this store. But we thought we have an extra Thursday night, since adjourning has been moved to Tuesday night. We have an extra Thursday night, so we thought we would start opening the store on that Thursday night from like 5 to 7:30 or something. So if people wanted to come in, that usually don't take time to look at the store or pass the word around. And we have new or slightly used stuff, and you know, we've got some really good stuff in there sometimes that we've sold for a good price, and you know, people give it to us, so whatever we get it, we're ahead of the game. So we're going to do that this week from 5 to 7:30 on Thursday. Then on the work day on Saturday, Ann's going to man the store from 8 to 12. So we'll have another day. Hopefully we can get some work and get some stuff sold. So what we get from these 2 days that we sell at the store, we're going to put towards the purchase of new chairs, and I want to get to that in a minute. Let's see, your class is starting tomorrow night? Yeah. Just stand up.
My class in the Old Testament is starting tomorrow night, and those who have signed up for it, I would appreciate them seeing me after this is over, because I want to give you your packet of lessons, so you can get started on reading them, and hopefully... Well, you'll get ahead of the game that way.
Thank you. And what time is your class going to be?
It's 6:30.
6:30, okay.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. Okay. All right, and also we're doing again, as we, you know, we're collecting things for Amy Jo and Kate as teachers, and we still are doing that. We've got a list for them and a box for both of them in there. Melanie said she didn't need anything, so that's good. We'll just pass it on to the other two. But also, Martha checked with Oak Grove. We wanted to make sure that they still needed help with the Pack and Snack program, and they definitely do. Did you, they get back with you, how many kids yet?
Yeah.
Okay. Normally, it's been about 30, 35 children that we've provided, tried to provide some stuff for the weekend for Pack and Snack. So we've got a list of stuff that was in the orders of service, and if it wasn't one, we'll give it to you. And Martha has a box set up, as always, for that. So. And that's an ongoing basis. We do that all year round for them, that help them out. And I know that I know kids personally that have had to use this program, and so it's very good. At least they'll have, we hope to have something for them to eat when they go home on the weekend. So we appreciate any help that you can give with that. Also, coming up the end of the month, Becky's mother is going to be 94, okay. And so, anyhow, we thought as a church that as many people that will just send her a birthday card. So we'll get the address for her, for you, and it's what, the 27th? I know it's a controversy there.
It's the 29th.
The 29th.
Really the 25th.
There's a story behind that. But anyhow, at the end of the month, and so I'll get the address, and as many people that will just send her a birthday card. I think it's great when we can do that for them. So lastly, I wanted to talk, we have been talking, you know, we're going to get the sanctuary painted because we've done things for the outside to improve the outside, but we need to do some things on the inside to improve the church. And so we're going to get the sanctuary painted, but we also have been talking about new chairs. Well, buying a chair is not just go to the store and buy chairs. Anyhow, Ann and I have been researching, and we've talked to people, and to make a long story short, we found some chairs that we liked from this company that in Texas. And So, but you, I said, well, not buying chairs until we can try one. Well, they won't just sell you one chair. But the owner there was willing to sell us one on display. But the sales lady, she said, I hate for y'all to spend this money when you can't buy, when you won't be able to use it. So she did some research and she sent me an email and she said, do you know where Churchville, Virginia is? And I said, yes, I grew up out there. So talking about things in order. So yesterday, Doug and Ann and I took a trip to Churchville. Of course, Doug thought we was never going to get back. He said, call him and tell him we won't be back for church tomorrow. But it was beautiful country out there, and there's a church called Jerusalem Chapel, and it was a beautiful church, an older church. They have 300 chairs that they bought. I don't know where these 300 people come from in this community, but they were willing for us to come look at the chairs. And so not only that, when we got ready to leave, the minister said, would you like to take one for people to try? So we have a chair for you all to try. Rita's sitting in it. So that, talk about things working out. They worked out really well.
It's very, very comfortable.
So anyhow, and I told him, I said, well, that's great, because we'll take it back, and we'll have it here this Sunday, next Sunday, then the following week. I'm taking it back because I have a family reunion up there. It worked out.
Nice.
So God is good. What can I say? So anyhow, everybody take a turn at sitting in this chair before you leave today and let us know what you think about it. Then again, we have, you know, you have to pick out the color, and a lot of us had said either red or green, and then when we three saw the blue, we like that, but picking out another color and picking out the wood, it's all a process of picking out a chair, so it's not like just going and picking out a chair. So anyhow, but this is going to be in the process, and as you know, or some of you know, we had $3,000 donated to help go to the purchase of these chairs, and we'll be doing some fundraisers to get some more money, but also once we get the exact cost of one of them, if somebody's willing to pay for just one chair, if they want to buy a chair, donate money for that, we'll have that going on too, so hopefully we can get... our goal is to get 60 chairs to start with, and that we have like 57 in here now. So anyhow, that's what's going on. But Ann and Doug and I had a really good time yesterday. It was fun, and so it was well worth the trip. And we bought back a chair. So Ann got in the car thinking, we have a chair. So anyhow, it was fun. Do check out the chair. Let us know what you think about it. So and then Doug, I might even take you back with me to take it back. Yeah, it was fun.
Jan, I got so into your storytelling. I was supposed to lead. All right. Our closing hymn is number 40, It's in Every One of Us, and we will sing both verses. Number 40, It's in Every One of Us, both verses.
Thank you.
shake hands for our final blessing. Okay, we're hand in hand, affirming that these are wonderful truths we've heard. Truths that make life so much more meaningful, so much freer, so much more filled with love. And we have come to know also that death holds no fear for us. We are moving into a greater freedom than we have known, greater love, greater good. For that, for all our blessings, we say, thank you, beloved Father. Amen.